What do you think, you little ham hock? Are we live? Is it going? Are we ready to start? You're saying we should start the show? Okay, we'll start the show. This episode of the Unwashed Asses is brought to you, as always, by cats. Cats bring every episode and joy into our otherwise dark and bitter hearts. And of course, patreon.com/0and09. If you dig into the show and you dig what I do over across all the different projects I do, I'm not going to list them all. I do a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff. And I need a lot of money to keep this habit going. again, head over to patreon.com/0and09. Pitch in a buck or two a month. I don't charge per episode and I don't charge anything, but every little bit helps and appreciate it. Down, checking the actual audio levels. It's a little hard because I have a 13-pound cat like headbutting me ferociously, trying to get my attention. I don't know what his deal is. He wants all the love. Come here, come on, get off the desk. Come on. Hey. Oh, God, you're so heavy. So video viewers are going to be in for a treat. Audio, you should hear the tinkling of his collar and the purring and the rubbing and all that fun stuff. So, today's episode, little late, sorry, overslept. And it is the season of the cable guy where the people are coming up to their lake homes and they need to have their cable and internet ready and a lot of OT. So, I ended up sleeping in. I slept in quite a bit and I feel bad, but at the same time, it felt great. And then today's going to be probably a little bit of a shorter episode, just for the fact that I do have a hard out. I've got way too much stuff to do today, so it's okay. We're going to power through it. I didn't want to, you know, miss another day and have everybody pestering me and say, hey, where's the episode? What the fuck's going on? And all that stuff. So instead, come here. You're being just a big old pain in my butt. Lay down. this asshole. Are you done? Are you gonna calm down now? All right. So, I figured out what to do as far as the claws in my chest and my arm. As far as the weight loss goals are concerned, what we're gonna do is on the Unwashed Asses website, theunwashedasses.com. I'm going to be putting up a chart, essentially tracking anybody who wants to enter in. The idea being that top three people will get a goodie bag, so to speak. I'm not sure what that might be. It's probably going to be a couple Steam or Origin keys, digital sketch, and some other fun stuff. So if you want to take part in our year-long weight loss challenge, or 6 months because, you know, the year's half over, then shoot me an email over at theunwashedasses@gmail.com. Write whatever you want, but essentially the basic info that I'm going to need is name, current weight, target weight, and then what we'll do is regular updates. So if you want to get in on it, you'll just need to, you know, either shoot me a message on Twitter or do an email as far as where your current weight is. So it'll be good motivation, I guess, because my fat ass is going to be posting how much I weigh on a regular basis to the entire world, and you can judge me, and if I relapse, then everybody can come down on me. And then it's that accountability thing where we can look at one another. Don't lay on my phone. We can look at one another and say, oh, you know, Jim, Joe, Bob, and Susie May, they've hit their weight loss goals for this week. Good job, you know. It's like I use Duolingo to learn German, and they have a clubs feature in there where up to 10 people can join a club, and your activity is logged amongst the other members, and at the end of the week they see who has gained the most points by doing the most lessons. And then there's a little leaderboard, and you can see what lessons other people have completed. So it works for me in that motivation sense. So I figure we'll do something like that for this, for the weight loss. And we'll see how it goes. So look for more details on that as I get the site updated. But good news, you know, I'm down to 225 now. So 5 pounds in 1 week. I'm not sure if it's because of the heat and I've just been sweating like a motherfucker at work. But yeah, so 5 pounds down and I didn't really do anything different. So yay me, yay me. What else we, your tail flipping everywhere is not happening. Like, you guys are going to get an unflattering shot of my crotch here, but for the video viewers, this is what I'm dealing with. Him and his flippy tail. So, I always find that motivation is one of the hardest things that I have to deal with, in the sense that, good to know, Darkwing. Darkwing says, I went to the gym last night, did not take a shower, now I have an unwashed ass. I think we all have. Don't chew on that cord. Get. Sorry. Cat decided to chew on the power cord. So, not to derail too much further now that the cat's gone. Motivation is usually the hardest thing that I have to deal with as far as getting stuff done and getting it out in a timely fashion. I always wanted to, well, not always, for the past year, year and a half, I had this idea that write a short story, publish it, one a month. You know, a short story typically is 7,500 words. Easy enough to count to do. If you do 500 words a day, that gives you 15 days you have it done, and then another half a month to do edits and rewrites. Go ahead and get those all together, publish one a month, and at the end of the year, do an anthology, and of course do it all on like Amazon Kindle, make it easy. The problem has been that I just don't do it, and so I've had that idea. I wanted to do it in 2016 and now 2017, and I've only published one. I haven't done any more, and so now we have the year of making myself better. Effectively, I don't know what's happened. I've got a weird bug up my ass, and not like the good pleasurable kind of bug up your ass, so the one like, what are you doing with your life? You need to fix this. Why are you a terrible piece of shit? Stop it. You're hurting yourself and everyone around you. .com. So I actually published a short story, Jake. So I actually started writing again. I am taking a concept, like every time my son's over, we'll before bed read a bedtime story and do all that fun stuff. And part of it is not just, reading from the little library he's got building up, but it's also telling one another stories. And so he'll tell me a story, I'll tell him a story, and we'll, just kind of build on it week after week after week. And so one of those stories is actually building into kind of like this little anthology series where we have a recurring character who is going on different adventures. And I figure, you know what? Why don't I just write that shit down? Why don't I formalize it? We're going to turn it into a story, and then fuck it, publish it. Let's make some money. Let's get some fat dollar bills in these pants and pay the rent and all that other fun stuff. And if nothing else, then my son has a physical copy of, the stories we used to tell one another. And I sat down to start writing on it the other night, and It was hard. Like, I've writing's one of those few things that comes very naturally to me. It's easier than talking. I'm a terrible speaker, and it's a matter of I don't really set up outlines or drafts or do the bullet points and all that stuff when I am writing. It's just a matter of open up Word and just go. And once I have my first rough draft done, then go back and make the edits as necessary. But for the most part, it comes out fairly well. But Monday night, I'm just like, well, no, Monday. No, it was Monday. Because either way, this is why you don't work so much, kids. Go to school or get into a trade that allows you to work only one job and live comfortably, and find one person that you can live with and share expenses, because on your own it's hard as hell unless you're making a good deal of money. And then you don't have to work 8 million jobs like myself and then fill it with hobbies. So sitting down and writing, and the goal again is 500 words in one session, which isn't hard to do. You can crank it out in easily, you know, 15 minutes to a half hour. And to track this, I'm using Scrivener. Scrivener itself is a fantastic little app is in terms of setting goals, organizing thoughts, and actually writing content. And the best feature that I found in it is the actual word count tracker. So if I create a new project, like I want to write a new book, then I can say, well, here's the target goal, here's how many words it needs to be, here's how many I need to write in this one session as well. And it will actively track as you write. And so I'll keep that little counter up in the corner of my screen while I'm writing. And then before you know it, usually what happens is I've reached my goal, and then I'm like, okay, I'm done for the night. I can just, you know, shelve this until tomorrow. But when telling those stories to my son, it was always a matter of like, all right, we're going to jump into why are we dropping frames like a son of a bitch? Hold on. Something went really fucky there. Do we just have too many tabs open? Damn it. Done. Close all this. Close this. Yeah, for whatever reason, I apologize. It just decided that it was going to shit out. So let's close all this unnecessary garbage. Okay, it's sustained. We're fine. Everything's cool here. Everything. How are you doing? Are we doing okay? So I'm sitting there writing, and it's not going up. The word count's kind of staying the same, because when telling these stories, we're jumping straight to the action, and we never really establish the world or the character itself, or gave him much of a backstory. It's just he's doing these things, and I have to fill in those gaps now. And part of me is like, no, just, you know, jump to the parts that you know, where he's doing X, Y, and Z things, and then you can go back and fill in the rest of the stuff. But again, that's not how I write. And so I'm sitting there struggling, like, well, I've bitched a whole hell of a lot about, like, Lovecraft and Irving as far as how descriptive they are on sceneries and setting and all that, and here I am, like, describing this idyllic cottage and the babbling brook and this magical forest and this faraway land and really trying to affect, like, a narrator tone, and it's coming out kind of like garbage. I always think everything I do is absolute shit. That's how I constantly improve. But looking at this, it's like, wow, it's been way too long since I've actually sat down and wrote something, and it's showing. The next couple nights, you know, it's gotten better, it's gotten easier, and so that, like, writing a bike analogy is coming into play here. But fuck's sake, it was rough. So the idea is that we'll have this published by the end of the month. So end of June, we'll have that up, and, you know, I'll, of course, shamelessly whore it out because that's what I do. And be interested to see what you guys think. But I'm curious to see what, if anybody else has written anything, what your thoughts are, what your methodologies are. I did buy Andrew Main's publish a short story or how to write a novella, whatever, in 24 hours. And that's like if you're going balls to the wall, focusing only on that. And it can be done. I know when I got out The Punishing Beast a couple of years ago, I wrote the bulk of that in like an 18-hour span. And while I got favorable reviews, at least those that told me about it, I should go back and reread that because I do want to do a sequel to that this year. But I'm going off on a tangent here. Let's move on. Fuck me, it's hot. And they always say, oh, it's not the heat, it's the humidity. And I say, you know what, fuck the heat, fuck the humidity, and fuck you too. I always like to keep it a nice, you know, chill. I don't like sweating and having boob sweat and feeling like a miserable, slimy piece of shit, because that's what happens. You know, you get this film, and it's disgusting, and awful, and you know, in the fall and in winter, they get that nice breeze and everything's chill, and don't you dare come back over here. So the heat's kicking up around here. We're sitting at 74. It says it feels like 74, but there's zero breeze moving in here, and I don't have any fans because I'm retarded. So the heat's getting to me, and I'm fitting like a poodle in a parka, and it's awful, and it's distracting. So, in the other show I do, Zero Lives, don't you come over here too. Both of you, just fuck right off. Zero Lives, we've been playing Fable 2 for several weeks now. Last Monday we made it up to the part where we're introduced to Reaver, and I know Jake here is super excited about that because he's a terrible human being who loves other terrible human beings like Reaver. No offense intended, I love you very much. And it made me realize that this particular series is going to be coming to an end very soon, because Reaver's the last character, the last hero that you have to recruit before you take on Lucien. And I'm sad that it's coming to an end. I know that we can go play Fable 3 afterwards, and there's another chicken soup, but something happened in playing this that I didn't expect, that I didn't count on. Oh, you're playing through it too? That's awesome. That's awesome. And what's happening is that I'm... Fable, one thing it's never really done is done well is made me identify with the character. The main character is supposed to be you, the hero, and the entire game is shaped around the decisions that you make. And what happens is that it never, like, probably the biggest thing is they never allowed you to do any customization. You're kind of stuck with what they give you as far as facial and body structure, especially in Fable 2, where if you put perks into the strength stats, your guy's going to get big and bulky, and they strap, like, this weird 8-pack on the front of him, so it looks like he's wearing, like, muscle body armor. And then if you go the magical route, you start getting these magical lines all over your body, which makes sense. The more you do something, the more you're going to start looking like that, but... Again, I'm a very vain person. I like pretty things and pretty people and my characters to be pretty. And so when he is just this big walking mound of meat and magic lines, then suddenly I'm drawn into the chicken suit because it hides all of that. And so the idea behind the series is, rather than do all the side quests, yes, and we should totally play Fable 3 together, Jake. I've beat it once, and I'd be really interested to see how we do it together. But with the series, streaming it, I decided, you know, if I do all the side quests, because there's a ton of shit to do in Fable, then I need to stick to the main story, and we'll focus on that, because the entire reason I got away from shooters and multiplayer games on the stream was it's hard to be engaging and actively talk about what it is I'm doing and be funny while I'm just killing people over and over again or getting killed myself. Whereas if we're playing through a story, then it gives me something to focus on. It gives me material to work with. And so the same train of thought comes into working with large open world games like this, where the side content can give me filler, but it's distracting. It's not as developed as the main storyline may be. So we're going to stick with the main story and focus on that, and then I can do all the side project and side quest shit on my own, and then come back and next week and we'll pick up. Well, the problem is secretly I hated the chicken suit. I did it as a gimmick. I totally forgot that I had the chicken suit in that game, and so when we came across it, of course, you know, I'm going to play to the audience and we're going to throw on the chicken suit. But what happened is he became real. He became a character to me. He became somebody that I cared about. And when we named him the War Chicken, that only doubled down on that effect, to the point where as I was playing through the game on my own and doing the side story stuff and becoming like this ruthless land baron, I would take the chicken suit off of the character and then dress him up how I wanted to. I would do his hair and all this extra stuff. And I realized that the character I play on my own is not the character. You know, the character is War Chicken. It's almost like you know, Batman and Bruce Wayne, to the extent that Bruce Wayne is the mask that Batman wears when he has to interact with other people. And Batman is the real character there, to the point where recently, I don't remember which comic run it was, since they're reintroducing all the DC heroes again, where Wonder Woman, Superman, and Batman are meeting for the first time, and she holds out her golden lasso of truth, and they put their hands on it to tell them, you know, each other their real names. And it's like Diana Themyscira and Kal-El Clark, and Batman, instead of saying Bruce Wayne, says Batman, because that's who he is. And when it hit me that that's who the War Chicken is, it was taken aback, because one, this goofy, stupid thing I had been doing became real to me, and I'm going to be sad when this character is retired effectively. And then two, the way I would typically play the game becomes the mask. He becomes the falsehood, whereas the War Chicken is who he actually is. When I walk through Bowerstone and people are commenting on him, and my new in-game wife is saying, you know, I'd be, you know, it'd make me really happy as if maybe you looked a bit better. And people always comment on how silly he is. That is built into the lore of who this character is to me. So when I put on the snazzy duds and do the hair and make him look like a proper adventurer, that's him dressing up as Bruce Wayne. That's him putting on a costume so he can blend in with other people. And when that happened, I found it, I didn't expect it. And so it gets me excited for other series that we can do and play together, and in the sense that once Fable 2 is done, what game do we move on to next? You know, I'm thinking we can go back to Layers of Fear, where we have the alcoholic painter going through, you know, his house and figuring out, you know, what's going on with his psychosis. And then two, is that going to develop as another character? Are they going to take on a life of their own And if so, I'm excited to see how that plays out. It really makes me want to go back and play a game like Amnesia, where, much like Portal, the main character we get is a pretty blank slate. We have a driving motivation to push the story forward, but otherwise, we're kind of left to our own devices as far as how the character develops. And we're trying to figure out why the character is doing what they do, especially so in Amnesia, where it's just that the character has no memory of what's happened and they have to figure all that out. And so it's fun to play with that, and I'm excited because that was one of the first games I had played in the Zero Lives series was Amnesia. And so, yeah, we're gonna go back to that and we're gonna finish it. So, I don't know, I'm curious to see what thoughts are on it, if the war chicken has won other people over, if they're falling in love with him much the way I have, and if it's an unexpected, is it unrequited love? Is it something you look forward to? Or are you like me, where you're sad and wondering what's going to happen as the series progresses? In I don't know. I mean, it's bittersweet in that sense that I just decided to pick on a lark because I'd read the Fable novel, and like, oh, you know what? Let's go back and play the game, and it'll make perfect fodder for Zero Lives, and it's hit me in an unexpected way, and I guess that's part of why I started doing the streams and the shows was. I got this weird bit of nostalgia in me where I like to go back and look at past projects and things, and this is a great way to do it to see where I was in that point in life and relive it because as much as I hate myself, I like watching my shows, maybe because I'm a narcissist. But it's an interesting thing to see, like, oh, these aren't actually all that bad. And I had that where yes, Dexter, you're very handsome and you're stealing all the camera. I had that where I was going through old photos. I have a very large collection of pictures that I've stolen or just saved from the internet in all the years that I've had a computer. And with each computer build, it goes forward. OneDrive has made this easier. And so I went down this weird rabbit hole of where I'm looking at old photos and pictures, and these can be like wallpapers, concept art, scenery, things like that. But each and every one I look at, it has a story, and I remember where I was at life when I saved it and why I decided to save it, and what meaning it has for me. And it went, the entire roller coaster of emotions were like happy, sad. A lot of sad, even more sad, downright depressing, and then also like back into comedy, and yep, it is Dexstar. But trust me, like when I found out that Atrocitus's cat is named Dexstar, and the fact that my own Dexter is a little angry tabby, if I was better with Dex with Atrocitus, he would be a main. Trust me, I was not anticipating moving into the Harley Quinn route, but yeah. The similarity is not lost on me. So nostalgia has been like this big kick I'm on right now, and the way the war chicken blossomed into it is interesting, and I don't know. It makes me want to go back and play a bunch of all these other old games. Like I did install Terra, and I've been playing that on really low settings, and I've been having fun with that. Looking forward to playing it on Xbox. And it makes me realize that overall in life, and not to get like too philosophical, that we only have so much time, and the secret to life isn't necessarily amassing a large fortune or having a big house or marrying that your high school sweetheart. It's building memories because they are they are the key to what I believe my purpose for life is being remembered. That's my driving force, is to build some type of legacy that lasts long after I'm dead and ground into dust or whatever. And so there are two ways to be remembered. One is to do things worth telling stories about, or to write stories worth telling. And so I've gone the latter route, because Cable Guy doesn't really lean towards memorable things. And so if I can tell stories that people tell their children and they tell their children, then that's my way of knowing that I've done good, or I've done something worthwhile in the world. And that's the entire reason I do the streams, and we started this Horror of Casitas network, and I write the short stories, and I do the webcomics, and all these other things. They are just so that I can have this maybe false belief that everything I've done will live on after I'm gone, that I will be remembered. And I don't know why I want that, because much like the show title suggests, the unwashed masses, or the unwashed asses, I don't like people. And why I want to be remembered, maybe it's this fucked up Napoleon complex. I don't know. I overall have a very nihilistic view on things, that nothing matters. I don't matter. You don't matter. In the grand cosmic scheme of things, we are a blip in the timeline of eternity. And I don't know, maybe it's just this inherent desire to want to be remembered for longer than I was around. It's weird and fucked up. And yes, Jake, you know what, why don't you and I, we're gonna plan a little dinner date, you and me. We're gonna do something special next Wednesday. Why don't we stream Injustice 2, and we will just go fucking banana sandwich on one another, because I think that'll be fun. Come on, Christian, you got this. Work the fucking soundboard. All right, it's going to be a shorter show, but again, I have a hard out. I have things to do today. Thursday mornings are the one little spot of time where I have time to work on a lot of side projects, and so trying to take advantage of it. And since I slept in, why am I reiterating this? Why do I keep talking about the in-game shit, the meta, the behind the scenes stuff? It drives me nuts when podcasts do that, where they talk about the show and instead of actually creating new content. So fuck it, I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm going to bitch about the Windows Phone. So when the time of iPhone and Android came about, I didn't have a smartphone initially. I had, for the longest time, those little track phones, the little candy bar Nokias, and then for a very long time, I had one of those super awesome, badass Motorola Razors. You were the shit if you had that phone. I loved it. Used it for a very long time. And I'm a little sad if I've lost it, because I can't think of where it is. Anywho, way back when, probably 2012, I think this was, Microsoft had announced that they were partnering with Nokia to release a Windows phone, a third phone operating system into the ecosystem. The one that, where Android had been dominating it with about 50% market share, iOS taking up the rest, BlackBerry, muddled in there. And they were touting it as essentially the second coming of Christ. It's going to be amazing. You know, they're doing all these great things, and the UI is great with the tiles, and and it's going to look different. It's going to have all this integration across like Facebook, Microsoft services, Google, all that. And it's going to be, you know, tied into their Windows RT platform and what they're doing with Windows 8. And so for my birthday, I got the Samsung Focus, which was running Windows Phone 7. And I loved it because that was the premier flagship phone for Windows Phone at the time. It was the first smartphone I had, and so going from the Razr to that, I was just blown away and astounded. And the fact that I had that integration with Facebook, my mail, my calendar, it was all displayed in a very easy, usable fashion. I could get apps now. I could do email in a functional manner. You know, at this time I still worked IT. It was the fucking cat's ass. I loved this phone. It was the best. And so I treasured it. I loved it. Despite all the hate and criticism it got from... sorry, give me one sec here, guys. Give me just one second. All right, sorry about that. I'm going to, you know, make a note here, Christian. 37 minutes in, edit that shit out. So, no, it got the phone and was digging it, and there was a lot of criticism from folks that had iPhones and ran Android that a lot of the apps that they wanted weren't available on the platform at that time. And my argument was always, you know, well, it does what I need it to. I didn't have a smartphone up to that point, so this is all new to me. It's all great. I love it. You know, how could it be any better? And give it time. Developers will come to the platform. Microsoft will get more market share, and then we'll have a viable third option. And then what happened was, when Windows 8 was coming out, they said, oh, we're going to go ahead and update the operating system for phones with Windows Phone 8. And instead of offering a direct upgrade to existing phone customers, you had to go get a new phone. So immediately, everybody that had jumped on to back this platform got a big old middle finger from Microsoft saying, fuck you. Your support's appreciated, but if you want to keep up with us, then you need to get a new phone, and we're not going to continue supporting Windows Phone 7, so fuck you anyways. I said, all right. At this point, I was a very loyal Microsoft whore. I was deeply entrenched in their ecosystem, and they could do no wrong in my eyes. And this was, you know, prior to time and for time after time of being, you know, fucked in the ass by Microsoft. So what happens then is Windows Phone 8 comes out, and we get a set of new phones. These are the flagship phones put out by Nokia. So, again, for birthday, I got the flagship phone, the Nokia Lumia 920. And the big thing that they're touting at this point was the Carl Zeiss optics, where the camera was superior to every other phone in the market, especially in low-light situations. And I'll admit, the phone and the camera was just fucking amazing. Now, the Nokia had the density of a dying star. And so when you held that thing in your hand, not only was it was a 5-inch screen, so it was already bigger than a lot of other phones. This is back when iPhone was still running smaller, same with Android. So when this thing came out, it was a fucking behemoth. It was gigantic, it was heavy, and you could kill a man with it. It was great. I loved it. Windows Phone 8 saw a series of upgrades that we then lost the integration between all the apps, where instead of going to like the People Hub and seeing what's going on with Twitter and Facebook and checking all the updates and posting updates from that, it was locked to individual app experiences. It was at this time that Microsoft and Google started fighting, and Google apps like YouTube vanished from the Windows Phone marketplace, and you had to start going to third parties. Continuing along with the third parties, when it came to actually getting apps like Snapchat or whatever the fuck everybody else used, you had to go to a third party because there was no official support for it on the platform. And at this point, I was still an apologist, I guess you'd call it, where like, okay, well, there's third-party alternatives. It ties in. You can still get, you know, some of what you're after, but it's still a good platform. I really dig the UI. The camera's great. I took a lot of photos with it, and it's durable. You know, one thing I never like doing is on my mobile devices is getting a case of any sort, because the phone should be designed to survive without the need of a case. And when you start throwing on, especially like screen protectors, I think it inhibits your ability to function with the phone. It's not as responsive. I had this problem with, I had a iPhone 6 for work, and as soon as we threw on the screen protector, it just became an unusable mess. And it was one of the OtterBox Defender series. I hated it. That being said, I use a Samsung Galaxy Note 5 for my new work phone, and OtterBox works great with that. It's fine, whatever, but it still makes it big and bulky, and at that point, your pocket is no longer functional. You can't just slide the phone in your pocket and go. You got this big rubbery piece of shit that you can't put anywhere unless you're carrying like a fanny pack, and heaven help you if you are a lady. You don't have functional pockets to begin with. So if you're putting a big old case on your phone, then you're doubly fucked. And then that just leads to, you know, bigger purses, and maybe it's a big conspiracy where the lack of functional pockets on your pants ties in. There's some Illuminati conspiracy between pants manufacturers and purse manufacturers. Like, keep making the small pockets, we're going to keep making bigger purses, and that's just going to line both of our pockets. Pun not intended, but delicious all the same. So, the Nokia was durable. There was a story that came out at the time. Exactly. And now, like Jake says, if you're wearing a hoodie, you need to have pockets that are functional. With hoodies that have, you know, the auxiliary cable that you can feed up through it, great, whatever. But at the same time, if you've got a big rubbery grip of a phone, it doesn't fit in the pocket well. But at the time, we had a story that came out of a police officer in India that got shot, and the goddamn Nokia phone stopped the bullet. He had a Windows phone, it saved his life. But that was more due to the durability of Nokia. They had incredible build quality, and Microsoft ran the brand into the ground, and they're just now regaining control to start manufacturing things under their own name. And so, continuing down the path of, all right, we went from Windows Phone 7 to Windows Phone 8, and now we have Windows Phone 8.1 when the 8.1 release hit for PCs on Windows 8. Okay, fine, you can upgrade, but only select series of phones can do the upgrade. It has to have this X amount of processing power. The problem was, at the time, Microsoft wasn't making a lot of mid to high tier phones. They were making low tier phones because they were selling to third world markets. They were trying to get a lot of impact in the Chinese and Indian markets, which, great, they're going for population, they're going for bang for the buck, but if you were an enthusiast, you were left out into the cold. And so, you know, fast forward to 2015, 2 or 3 years into the lifespan of this new phone, where it's only taken up 3% of market share. At this point, Windows Phone is beating out BlackBerry, but that's not saying anything because RIM is literally circling the drain. They are just about dead. And there's no traction. There's no third-party support. Apps, developers aren't creating anything or porting their existing stuff over. There had been a long rumor of a new application within Microsoft's Visual Studio that would allow developers for Android or iOS to port their code into it, which would then make it into a viable Windows Phone app, which then you could also use, because at this time they're integrating the Windows 8, Windows 10, and Windows Phone stores all into one thing. But you never heard anything further on it. At that time, you thought, oh, this is going to be the thing that saves Windows Phone. We're actually going to see apps come about. But nothing happened with it. And so when I went to the Microsoft Device Night in Chicago in 2015, and they're showing off Windows Phone 10 to coincide with Windows 10. They skipped 9 because Microsoft and its infallible logic said, oh, it was a fucking train wreck. Might as well just jump ship right to 10. But much like they did with Windows Phone 7 upgrading to 8, only a select, at least at this time when you were going from 8 to 10, a select certain few handsets were capable of installing the upgrade. But if you jumped in early like I did and got the premier flagship phone, another big old middle finger from Microsoft, you're not getting your upgrade. You can't install Windows 10 legitimately on the phone. That being said, I found workarounds and signed up for the Insider program and downloaded it, and you know what? It was a buggy fucking mess. It made my phone unusable. And much like they did with Windows Phone 7, if you're running the old Windows Phone 8, go fuck yourself. Another big middle finger from Microsoft. That, great, thanks for supporting us from the get-go. Fuck off unless you want to buy a new phone. And you know, fast forward a couple of years, where we're 2017, and now Microsoft is shutting down its own services for its own goddamn phone platform, where they have announced Skype is going away on Windows Phone. So effectively, the device that felt like I was using a brick is now just that. It's a brick. It's a glorified paperweight. I can't even go to the store, install basic apps to use it as like an MP3 player or a player for podcasts, or let my son use it to play games, because there's nothing on it. It's useless to me now. All in the span of, what, 4 or 5 years? Microsoft had this great idea and ran it into the fucking ground. And that's kind of par for the course with them, where if something isn't working out, they're just getting rid of Skype on the Windows Phone and Windows RT side. Skype is sticking around. Don't confuse me, Jake. You can still get it on every other platform except for Windows Phone, effectively, because RT got phased out ages ago. But yeah, it just goes to show you that when Microsoft sees any hint of roadblock, they shut their shit down and they stop supporting. It's why Bing and MSN Weather and all those stuff, it constantly gets rebranded. It was aggravating on the sense that I like using Bing Weather. And so when I made the jump from Windows Phone over to Android, again, not so much support. They're constantly renaming things, and it's a big old piece of shit. And it's aggravating. It is so goddamn aggravating. Because it's hard to support a company that whose products you like at the core when they don't support you. And I feel that this rant's been cathartic. It's been a long time coming. I had so much hope and promise and took so much shit for using a Windows phone for years that it's good to let it out. And you know, make that jump to Android, where I'm now using Microsoft's Aero launcher as my UI. Still using Exchange, running an Exchange server for my email. I use their weather. Like if I could turn the goddamn Android phone into a Windows phone, I would. I've tried. But, you know, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? So, that's my sad story. And that's going to wrap it up. You know, it's been a little roller coaster of a ride, waking up late, recording a short show, bitching and moaning for 50 minutes. But I think it's good. So we'll be back next Thursday, 9 a.m. Central Time. the only time zone that matters. I don't give a fuck what Scott Johnson says. And then, of course, it's a Nokia. I can't turn it into a batarang. I can't destroy it. It's indestructible. That thing, that will be my legacy. This phone will live on long after I'm dead and gone, just because it's a Nokia. But, yeah, Friday Night Smite, check that out tomorrow, 9 p.m. Central Time, and of course, Zero Lives Monday nights at 9. Toodles. You are beautiful, but then beauty comes at such a price, and I know that you'll soon disappear.